welcome you here tonight, and we have come together tonight to just share some time together in adoring the Lord Jesus Christ, just celebrating his birth and then remembering why he was born. He was born to die for our sins. So I'm glad you're here. I said this morning, and I'll say again, I believe this will be, this service, even in its simplicity, this service will be one of the highlights of your Christmas season and of your Christmas worship. And so I'm glad you're here. Let's bow in prayer together. Heavenly Father, we, Lord Jesus, we gather in this room tonight and we adore you. Lord, we sing and we worship in adoration for who you are. We're thankful tonight for our salvation in Jesus. We're thankful that you loved us so much that you left the splendor and glory of heaven to be born in a manger, to live a sinless life, and then to be the perfect sacrifice for our sins. And Lord, we're thankful for your birth, for your life, and for the death and burial and resurrection of Jesus. Lord, we have come here to adore you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand and join us as we continue to sing praises.
Joyful, Lord, ye nations.
appreciate how music today has taken us from the staple to the table. We have been reminded all day long of the reason for the birth of our Savior. And I want us, just before we take communion together, I want to take a look at a verse found in Luke 19, verse 10. It says, "For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost." One of the questions people often ask is, why was he born? And what difference does it make? Why was Jesus born? And does his birth really make a difference in our life? I know it makes a difference in the month of December. But does it make a difference on December the 26th? Does it make a difference in the coming year? And the answer to that question is found in this verse. And we'll just break it down together. The first part says, the Son of Man has come. And that is a magnificent historical fact. The fact is, some 2,000 years ago, the Son of God became the Son of Man, that the sons of men, that's us, could become the sons of God. God the Son left the glory of heaven and was born in a manger. He left that which was light and entered into our darkness. He left the splendors of heaven and entered into our squalor. From purity, he came to live in a world of sin. Galatians 4, verse 4 says that when the time had fully come, God sent forth his Son. Meaning that at the perfect time in history, the time that was planned by God, the birth of Jesus was no accident. It had always been the plan of God that if he were to act in creation, that he would act in redemption. So from before time began, it had always been God's plan to send his Son to be born, to die on the cross of Calvary for our sins. It was not an accident. It was the plan of God. God came to us in the person of Jesus Christ. And I know I said it this morning, but it still amazes me. God came to our earth. God came and lived among us. He was here. And the innkeeper and the town people, the religious leaders, the political leaders of that day, Herod, Jesus was right there. God was right under their nose, and they missed it. My hope and prayer is that you're not missing it, but the historical fact is that the Son of Man has come. Now, he also, you see in this verse, a spiritually significant mission. Why did he come? Well, the verse says, to seek and to save. He came looking for someone. When Jesus came, he came looking for someone. He came looking for blind beggars and lepers and the self-righteous and fishermen and wild men and tax collectors and adulterers and the rich and the poor and the prostitutes and the drunkards. As I said this morning, he came to help those of us that were in a mess. He's often called the seeking Savior. And he came to help those of us that were in a mess. I shared with you this morning that Christmas means that we come to the end of ourselves and we realize we can't help ourselves because we're in a mess. We're sinners, and that's who Jesus left the glories of heaven to come, to seek, and to save. A spiritually significant mission. And then we see a description of the state of humanity, that which was lost. Man in that time and in our time was doing their own thing, going their own way, living a life of hopelessness. God came to redeem them. People, men and women, young people, tangled in a web of sin. Jesus didn't come to earth as just a casual visitor. He didn't come to earth just to look at what was going on, but he came to seek and to save those that are lost. And in Jesus Christ, we see God's love, God's mercy, God's grace, God's kindness, God's justice, and God's holiness. It is in Jesus Christ that we see the joy of Christmas. But in the celebration of the joy of Christmas, always know that it leads to the agony of Good Friday. We get sentimental around Christmas. But do not forget that the babe of that manger grew into a man that one day went to the cross of Calvary and shed his blood for our sins. He was born for it to end up that way. He was born for that reason. And so as we celebrate Christmas, I think it's important that we also come together and partake of the Lord's Supper. We're never told in Scripture to celebrate or even remember his birth. Never in Scripture are we told to have Christmas. But we are told to remember his death. And so I think it's important for us during this time of year to come together, and as we celebrate the manger, we also need to remember the cross, and we need to remember the empty tomb. And let me say, the manger means victory. Cross is victory. The empty tomb is victory. It's all about the victory that we have in the room of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's going to be my privilege tonight to serve you the Lord's Supper. And here's what I want us to do. We'll come, and I would like for you to, as best you can, to come as family units. Come together as family. Most of you are sitting together as family. Come together as family units, as friends. And then come and take the element from me. Go back to your seat and we'll have a time of prayer. And then we'll partake of the communion together. And so let's begin with the bread, which represents his body that was given for us. And we'll just begin, we'll just start right over here, and we'll just come together and come as family units, as friends, and then go back here.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you for Jesus Christ. Lord, in his willingness, Lord, to leave the glory of heaven to come down here in the darkness of earth. Lord, in his willingness, Lord, to do your will here on earth, Lord, to go to the cross and to die and to give his body for us. We just thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. We were given a candle when you came in tonight, and we're going to have concluding singing of Silent Night, the Holy Night, and they're going to come on up and get ready for that, and then we're going to have the lighting of the candle signifying that Jesus is the light of the world, and because he shines, we're to leave this building tonight shining forth the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ in our life. And so just as the song is sung and as we sing together, And just remember that in the midst of a dark world, the light of life was born in Jesus Christ. Salvation, the light of direction and guidance in our life. We're thankful tonight for Jesus. Lord, we're thankful for your birth and your life, and we're thankful that you came to seek and to save those that are lost. Lord, we're thankful for the victory that we have in Jesus Christ. Lord, we're thankful for the victory of the manger, the victory of the cross, and the victory of the empty tomb. And Lord, I pray that as we leave here tonight, that as we go out into this dark world, that we will be the light of Christ to those that need to see him. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now hold on. Don't blow your candles out. I read an article this week, and they said one of the dangers of a candlelight service is that we come and we worship and we have a wonderful service together, and then we blow out the candle. And we got to do that, or the place will burn down. But it seems to be that we burn out the candle, and figuratively speaking, we burn out the candles in our hearts and in our lives. And we say, you know what, I've done the religious thing for Christmas, and boom, we're out the door. And I just encourage you to take the light of Jesus Christ with you throughout the entire Christmas season, but throughout the entire year. Let us be in... The world is broken. The world is dark. But the darker the room, the lighter, the brighter the light shines. And so in this dark, evil world, let the light of Christ shine forth even brighter. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
All right, now we blow them out. All right, it is good to see you here tonight. We're going to have a time of fellowship over in our fellowship hall. And so you all invited... We need lights on probably, but we're going to hit those lights. You're all invited to go and be a part of that. And I say to you, Merry Christmas, and may God bless you. All right, good night. God bless.